As with any new hardware, new games consoles have their strengths and weaknesses. Several of our staff have now spent more than a week with the Xbox Series X and S and have put together a list of the things they love about Microsoft's new boxes, as well as where both new Xboxes have room to grow.
The presentation when you open the Series X box is genuinely, honestly, the best I've ever seen in any console ever. It really feels like you're opening up something special, almost like a present. I think it's Apple-level good, if not better.
Setting up a console shouldn't be a pleasure, but somehow Series X makes it one. After a quick sync up, the entire setup process can be handled through the Xbox app. It's simple, seamless, and feels somehow futuristic, not to mention lets you check in on other settings while your new console downloads and installs its initial update.
In a world where tech is starting to think outside the box in design, I actually really love the modern look of the Xbox Series X. While much bigger, the upright orientation reminds me so much of Amazon's flagship Echo device. There's still a simplicity to it that doesn't make it stand out too much. I placed it right next to my TV standing straight up, and it kind of just blends right in. I don't even notice it's even there.
I'm thoroughly impressed by just how seamless migrating from the Xbox One to the Series X is. You barely need to lift a finger. A few hours after plugging in the external hard drive from my Xbox One X, my Series X had pulled down the upgraded version of Forza Horizon 4, put it straight on the SSD, grabbed my save from the cloud, and I was back on the road. You barely miss a beat. I'm also not sure it can be understated what a great ecosystem the modern Xbox environment has now become, with four generations of games living side by side on the same device. It's a crying shame the PS5 couldn't pull off the same trick.
I buy most of my games digitally these days, so it was really nice when I fired up my new Series X, logged into my Xbox account, and saw my digital game library, both old and new, fully populated. Likewise, it's great to be able to browse through and buy games from the Xbox Store on my PC or phone, and then tell it to automatically install my new purchases on the console remotely.
I really like that the console offers easy-to-use display options when you're setting your console to 4K, 1440p, 1080p, whatever you want. It's all there. You can set it to whatever your television or monitor can handle, and then configure the hertz to 60Hz or 120Hz from there. There's also a plethora of HDR, color depth, and general video settings that you can tweak to your liking, as well as audio settings that you can also tweak.
When Xbox says the Series X is part of an ecosystem, they mean it. There's something instantly satisfying when you log in with your Xbox Live account and find the digital games library you've been building since 2008. And yes, that means playing Sonic Adventure 2 on a Series X on launch day.
The Xbox Series X controller is the most solid feeling controller I think I've ever used. It has a nice textured grip that makes it easy to hold, and the new triggers concave perfectly on your fingers. The share button is a welcome feature that works incredibly well, allowing you to simply reach over and capture an awesome moment without any visual UI interruptions.
Honestly, I will never go back to a console that doesn't have Quick Resume ever again.
When Quick Resume works as advertised, it's magical. Being able to go from, for example, Sekiro to Gears 5 and be able to pick up exactly where I left off within less than 30 seconds is amazing and something that is truly unique to the Xbox Series X. I wouldn't think of having two games open at once on my PC that I could alt-tab between, and it's a feature that isn't available amongst any of its console competitors.
Expanding a modern console storage has never been simpler. USB 3.0 is great, but these new SSDs require a bit more heft, and the Series X couldn't make it any easier. No unscrewing, no removing panels. You just simply plug the SSD into the back expansion bay, and you're set.
I'm a fan of the Xbox Series approach to expanding storage space. Slotting in a snazzy memory card is a lot simpler than physically opening the console to add a drive. The problem is that for now, I will absolutely not be paying for the official 1TB Seagate drive. $220, and even more outside the US, is exorbitant for all but the kind of people that pay for those gold-plated consoles you see on the internet sometimes. The silver lining is that Microsoft says others will be able to make their own versions of the proprietary cards. We just need competition to drive down prices before it becomes a viable option.
Well, that hard drive fills up fast. It's only got 802 gigabytes of usable data when you account for the OS and system files.
As great as Quick Resume is when it works, it also doesn't work 100% of the time. I went from Gears to Sekiro and Quick Resume just fine on Sekiro, loading up right where I left off, but when I went back to Gears, I had to reload the whole game. The Series X just doesn't do a great job of letting you know what games are currently suspended or whether or not switching out of a game will close it out, which can be particularly bad with games like Yakuza Like a Dragon, which relies largely on manual saves. I've definitely lost a bit of progress thinking my game would be suspended, but it wasn't.
Share functionality could use some work. The recording times are pretty short, even in 1080p. I've also had it slightly glitch out when trying to save those big 4K clips.
The launch lineup is slim pickings. And if you're not into Ubisoft open world games or basketball, it's even slimmer. Sure, 2021 looks great, but is there enough here now that really says, welcome to a new era?
Where do you stand on the Series X and Series S? Let us know in the comments and be sure to check out our in-depth reviews and tech analyses of both new Xboxes and the PS5.